La Plagne in the French Alps. We're 1,350 metres above sea level, high in the clouds, falling with snow around this 1992 Olympic venue. We're here for round five of the Viessmann FIBT World Cup. It's the second heat of the two-man bobsled. Martin Haven and women's Olympic champion Kaylee Humphreys calling the action. And Kaylee, your teammate Lyndon Rush leading here, but look how close this field is. Top five, 1,500ths of a second. Even Holcomb, 1,900ths back in sixth place.
It's close racing, closer than we're usually traditionally seeing here, so it should be a good race and a good second round. It'll come down to consistency and the driving and the starts.
One of the big surprises, Simone Batazzo, started the season with a hamstring tear last year, had a horror story here. He lies in third place, 500ths of a second off the lead. Only one of last year's podium finishers, Bernd Hefti, is in the top three. He was in the bronze medal position last year. He is in silver medal position here after our first of two heats. And he's 200ths of a second behind the race leader, Lyndon Rush. Now, we'd expect gaps this small in somewhere like Winterberg, but here in La Plagne, 1,500 metres of ice has produced the tightest race of the season so far. The biggest gap in the entire field is 400ths of a second between sleds, and that is just astonishing. It's snowing here at the top of the track, it's snowing everywhere now, Kaylee Humphreys, but the great thing about La Plagne is it's got a roof all the way down, and that means it doesn't matter what the weather does, you just carry on as normal.
It do. As an athlete, it's the safety mechanism. You know that on race day, no matter what runners you pick, you're picking according to temperature, not whether there's snow or not.
They've turned an outdoor sport into an indoor sport.
As much as you can.
As much as you can.
As much as you can. Snow's still going to blow in. There's still wind and rain and all the other factors that go along with snow. Usually means it's more humid outside, usually warmer temperatures, so you're picking runners and adjusting to temperatures that way, but overall you're not worried about getting hooped with big snow drifts in your way.
Well, that's what we were contemplating about the first heat. Our race winner last year, Thomas Florschütz, was the first man to start down the track, and he ended up in 20th place, tied with this man, in fact, for 19th, Rico Pater. We wondered whether the weather had something to do with it, maybe a little frost at the top of the track, but Kaylee, it's more fundamental than that. It's not the ice that has caused him these problems.
No, I don't think so. We'll see what happens, but from what I understand, could be sled setup, could be a lot of different things. So we'll definitely see how he does on second run, but not much can change between first and second run. So if it is the way that the sled is riding, different things that they would have tried, not much you can do about it. You just kind of got to take your lumps and chalk this one up to learning experience.
Well, Rico Pater, 20th fastest start in the first heat, 20th speed down at the bottom. Gets away in 6:18, 500ths of a second slower than his first start. And in a field of 31 sleds, for drivers like Rico, you know, the first thing was to get into the heat.
Definitely, as we had a strong field, 31 sleds, strong competition, the top 20 are good pilots, so, you know, making second run is sometimes a first goal, and then trying to come back and, you know, clean up second run from first round driving-wise.
Well, he'll be trying to move up the order, but the one that we expect to try and see move up a little further is Thomas Florschütz, who'll come next. It's a nice, smooth run. 19 turns of this La Plagne track, and it's almost constant corner to corner to corner. There's no straightaway apart from between the last couple of corners.
No, it definitely is, and everything is all in how you set it up. And you got to nail the first couple corners because one, like you said, one flows right into the other, and they're all important, and that's when you really gain and or lose time.
Well, 124.6 kilometers now down at the bottom of the track, 77.5 miles an hour. He finishes just a fraction slower than his first run, which is a 101.18. It's 101.27. And again, you know, for the drivers, lots of corners, it's a much longer track. It's about 15% longer than Winterberg, where we were last weekend.
Comes across there, just as you can see, just gets a little too early under that corner. You can see the pilot, everybody in that sled kind of lifts up. It's like when you go over a roller in your car and you just kind of get that little bit of a light feeling. Similar thing happens, and when that happens again, it's not smooth, it's not fast. Everything's going upwards instead of forwards.
Well, Thomas Florschütz, what to make of this? With Kevin Kuska, who's behind him today, they won in November 2011 on this track. And they drove away from Stephen Holcomb and Bernd Hefti. Tied for 19th is possibly, I'm suggesting, not quite what they had in mind for today.
No, and I can honestly say I've never seen this, and I don't think I ever will. Seeing a German this low down in the start is not a typical thing at all. And,
They had a good first start, 5.93. Fourth quickest start, 5.91. So until the moment he sits down, everything's looking good.
It is. And even the drive first run, so far the drive this one, not much to report, not much to say. I mean, it looks smooth, looks fast. He's on the right lines.
Well, he's a lot quicker in the first corner than he was in the first run. We were looking down the timesheets, and until you got into the mid to low 20s and into the 30s, no sleds were as slow through the speed traps as last year's race winner Thomas Florschütz.
No, and you see him just gaining time. He just seems to be getting faster and faster.
Well, whatever
tenths
it is,
of a second by each and every time clock. So, you know, maybe it was just as simple as the ice and going off first with it being a bit frosty. You never know. Sometimes, I mean, the top 10 are all a draw. Oh. That huge skid out of 18 into 19, that will cost him a lot of time. But he's really just trying to make up as many spots as possible. So,
okay, 60.57 seconds in the first heat. That would have left him our race leader. That is the single fastest run so far of the 33 sleds now that have gone down this track. So there you go. There was definitely something else, and it may well have been that the track was just too frosty at the beginning.
Could have been. You see that big skid here. He's going sideways on the track. He's really trying to get it straight again by moving those runners. All of that plays into a difference. Not a good straightaway from 18 to 19, but that was the only thing, honestly, to report. The rest of that run was really, really nice, and you see it in the time.
Well, look, he came down 6/10 of a second faster than his first heat. He was only 55 hundredths off the lead. He could be in the leader's box a long while.
Definitely, I think we're about to see that for sure.
Next up, Jürgen Lewacker of Austria, Matthias Adolf. They started 22nd in the draw, 23rd fastest start, but the Austrian only really comes into his own once he's got his bum planted in the sled, not before.
We'll see what Jürgen can do here at the start. Traditionally, not as strong of a start, and he's 6:26. He's way off the place, especially now that he's trying to catch Thomas and Kevin.
He dropped a tenth of a second to his own first start as well, so that's not exactly helping his case. A full kilometre an hour slower through that first speed trap, and that shows not only were they running slower, they didn't get as much energy into the sled, they didn't accelerate. He was 200 in front of Florschütz from the first heat. He's already 64 hundredths back. And after Thomas's first run, that surely is only going to grow. There's no coming back here, I don't think, for anybody except for maybe the top half dozen. 124.1, Florschütz 125.4.
Bit of a skid there again out of 18, but generally the run's pretty decent. I mean, Thomas just laid down a smoker, as we're traditionally used to seeing.
Yeah.
And, you know, a shame with starting first in first run, sometimes that's the way that it goes. We try and you think with the track being covered that it wouldn't make a difference, but it seemed to for them, and, you know, just makes it harder for the rest of the pilots that are coming down now.
Yeah.
It's a really close race.
Well, Lewacker, a full second slower on that drive alone than Thomas Florschütz. So Florschütz leads as the Austrians come into third place. Again, awkward load. He didn't get in cleanly the first time either. There's Thomas Florschütz, Kevin Kuska. Yeah. He said, how long are you going to stay there? Yeah, pretty much till the end of the hour, I'm thinking. Now, this would be a great story, Kaylee, if he could somehow win the race from joint last.
It would be. I'm pretty sure that isn't going to be possible because it is the combined time of both. I think he's going to be up there for a while, definitely for the next couple of sleds. We'll see what Patrice can do here, but again, not traditionally known for starts, and Thomas and Kevin really blasted it on that second, on both of their starts, so.
Yeah. Well, Monaco's Patrice Savelle was here racing last weekend in the Europa Cup, the second tier of sliding. Sled built by French bobsledding legend Bruno Mijon. 6:24 getaway again. That's not as quick as their first heat. Only Florschutz and Kuska, with something to prove, have gone quicker than their first start.
Overall, again, Patrice is a great driver. These lines looking smooth, looking clean. But he's got a huge person to catch, a huge team to catch, and the track just, unfortunately, I don't think is long enough. You're just going to see him lead time as Thomas just gained time the whole entire way down.
This is like a Formula One race where you put Sebastian Vettel, the world champion, in his Red Bull car right at the back of the grid. It doesn't matter if you're starting in front of him in your HRT or your Lotus. You know he's going to come by you. It's just a question of when. This is the same. Monaco, 1 second behind and drifting away. They have dropped down to fourth place. Wow. That's not even close to what they did in the first heat. That's 6/10 of a second slower. My goodness, this is, you know, Florschutz just saw everybody else just blindingly fast after him. And now looks like he's had the last of the ice and everybody else is running through slush.
Go, Rosie!
Well, this could be a very entertaining second heat, Kaylee.
It definitely could.
Right, let's get money on. We'll write in a sealed envelope where we think Florschutz is going to finish, and we'll open it at the end of the show. But again, you know, not too much to say about that run. It was pretty clean. Bruno Mijot on the right there. Maybe not as thrilled with that. Patrice Sebel will finish at the bottom of the pile. Well, next up, Chris Bringer, Canada. Started fourth out of start shed, and again, maybe didn't get the best of the ice. Certainly was looking strong early on, but subsequent, a whole bunch of sleds went quicker. Well, he was 100th in front of Patrice Sebel of Monaco, 200s ahead of Jürgen Nowacka, 400s ahead of Thomas Florschutz. He's going to have a smoking run to take the lead here.
He definitely does. Really pulling for him. Teammate, awesome guy. A lot of talent.
Look at the leg power of Adam Rozenki on the back handles.
You just see it, those legs whip, and the turnover he's got is unbelievable.
What a beast. 6:10 starting again. Not quite as quick as they managed in the first heat. Well, Florschutz and Kuska, 5:91. That's 0.20 of a second quicker.
Very nice four down into five, but hit out of three into four, so that's going to cost him a bit of time. Really, this track doesn't start to pick up until about quarter six. It's pretty flat. The velocity that you give it at the start is really what makes a difference down and until six. From six, it continues to get faster and faster and faster up until around corner 16, 17, and then it flattens out again up until the finish.
The gap to the leader is growing, but Chris Spring still in second place. Very good speed, 1:24.5. It's pretty much as quick as he was going in the first heat. Exactly the same speed as the first heat and the same mistake, 18:19. He wasn't going to catch Florschutz. Half a second back, only lost 1/100 down at the bottom because he had good speed. His first heat, 1:01.14. His second heat, 1:01.13. Not much you can argue about with that drive.
No, definitely not. Technically, it would have been a better drive. Has a faster downtime with a slower start. So he definitely made up some time there, but very consistent, which is always a big thing for most pilots. So consistent driving, not quite as good as he came in through last year, but competition seems to be tougher this year, so.
Well, a whole host of more sleds this year. America's Cup champion 2 years ago in two-man and four-man. Last year, his World Cup rookie season, of course, curtailed by that big crash in Altenburg. Still looking to recover all of that lost fitness. Well, next up, Nick Cunningham. At one stage, he was third in a US 1-2-3. That was at one stage. Then the track got quicker. First two-man start for his brakeman, Andreas Drebbel. Thomas Florschutz on the left, Kevin Kuska on the right. They're going to need some more warm clothes, the length of time they're going to be standing in the leader's box. Well, what can Cunningham do here? Again, they started decent, Kaylee, 6:02.
He has had a little trouble with that machine gun there. You really got to try and get that in and get those, you know, in. You don't want that sled and those runners cooling off on the ice. And it's a bit distracting for the pilots. You want to be able just to get it in and go right away.
has got a new BTC Latvia sled for this European campaign. 6.03 getaway again within a hundredth of their first start, so that's an exceptional starting from these two guys. And good momentum as well, 66.9, only one sled quicker. Guess who that was, our race leader Thomas Florschütz.
Okay.
Coming through, Nick seems to be having a really nice run. Seems to be driving this sled really well. Looks smooth, looks fast, but he's definitely, you know, far off the pace. You know, he seems to be bleeding time. I don't know if that's necessarily Nick or if Thomas just had an exceptional run or a combination of both. I think we're going to see that for this next, definitely quite a few sleds come down.
Absolutely.
Overall, you know, a good run for Nick, but how do you how do you compare to Thomas and Kevin, you know?
It's well, look, what you got to compare it to is Chris Spring. He was 100th in front of Spring from the first heat, and he's 1,200 in front of him from the second heat. So empirically, he's improved more than Spring did. But Florschütz is just way out of sight here. He got so badly hampered in the first heat, Florschütz. Again, Nick Cunningham, full of confidence this season. He's been having a really good year so far. Not bad for a rookie campaign, huh?
No, not bad at all. Impressive. It's kind of the one that you hope for, that you wish can come true. And, you know, it seems to be doing it. Velocities are great. Starts are good. You know, this is first time on all these tracks in World Cup, and he's doing exceptionally well.
There's an ex-surf bum who paid his way through college as a pro bull rider. You can get into bobsled from just about any avenue. Justin Cripps of Canada. This is Canada 3. Sam Giguère from Montreal behind him.
Go, boys!
So starting to get a few more French-Canadians coming through. With,
we are.
With
we
Chelsea,
definitely...
with Sam, with Jean-Nic.
Yeah, we definitely have quite a few representing. We Canada's pretty represented from coast to coast with all of our athletes. So we're pretty fortunate that way.
No newfies, yay?
No, not yet. I'm sure there still is one, but
he'll come.
Hopefully we find him.
6 seconds flat, 5.97 first heat, and again within 300s. That's about as close as you get. But again, World Cup rookie Justin Cripps, his first full season, and you know, threatening always to be right up in the top 10.
So far, having a nice run, good clean run. He is behind, but again, he's facing Thomas Florschütz and Kevin, so it's a tough one to call, but overall, seems to be having a very good run. I mean, like we can see, Cripps is one of, if not the only male pilot that does rock the goggles, just like I do, so that's not going to make a difference at this time. I'm really just pointing it out to represent.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, listen, this is insanely tight. He was 500s off the top 10, and he was in 15th place, 14th place. From 10 to 20, just 1,500s of a second covered those 10 sleds. This is unbelievably close for such a long track. As he slips down into fourth place, still Thomas Florschütz that has the lead. Well, 101.30, that's getting on for 3/10 of a second worse than his first heat. And it kind of looked it was just a bit jiggery everywhere.
It was. See him come off this corner, just the pressure he built in the corner, comes across, hits the left wall. He's really rubbing the whole wall all the way down the track, just the bunks are hitting it, you know, every couple inches, and that's just going to kill your time, tenths of a second instantly.
Looks back at his sled like he's trying to find the magnets that attracted him to that wall and wouldn't let him come off it. Next up, the first of our two Dutch sleds, 13th spot, 300s out of a top 10 first run. Nick de Bruyn with Broer van der Zijde behind him. Coach there, Nicky Minicello, the former women's world champion. Well, two Dutch sleds looking very strong here this weekend. De Bruyn, the rookie. Teammate Van Kalke in fifth spot.
They're doing the rock at the start as well. And as you can see on these Eurotech sleds, that push bar seems to be a little longer than most, which personally I feel gives me a bit of an advantage But compared to most of the hands, your hands as a pilot are able to be a little bit wider apart. And when you're pushing something, hands close together isn't as strong as wider apart. So an advantage zero tech sleds have.
Listen, these two are real beasts. 67 kilometers an hour, only one sled faster through that speed trap, and that's the race leader, Germany 1. He's only 800ths of a second behind him at the moment. Of course, the gaps were tiny. He was only 1,200ths up on floor shots from the first heat. Now he is in second spot. And the real question in this race now is not when floor shots is going to be beaten, but to my mind, almost if he's going to be beaten. 125 kilometers an hour, very good speed again from De Bruyne. This could put him into a top 10 finish.
Very nice run, 18 to 19 smooth. Overall, not much to report on this run. Very good run, 101.03, very consistent starts, very consistent drives. He should be very, very happy with today.
The two starts, 1/100th of a second apart. The two drives, 3/100ths of a second apart. That's great consistency from a rookie driver.
Yes, definitely.
Now, of course, he has raced on this track before. He raced in the Europa Cup last year, so he's been on it at least once, so that's good. What the brakeman felt that.
Yeah, he definitely would. A little bit high on that corner, but again, he's letting it run. He's letting it go through and just trying to react the best that he knows how, and it seems to pay off. He's got second fastest speeds at the bottom, so.
There's Ivo and Bro. Big Bro lad, as they'd say in Scotland, where Bro is strong and beefy. Kuska looks like he's couldn't care less, actually, at the moment. I think they're so depressed after that first run. Corey Butner and Justin Olsen of the USA. USA 2 sled in 12th place after the first heat. 1/100th ahead of the Dutch. And only 1/13ths ahead of Florschutz. 6:10 start, just a fraction slower than their first heat, Kaylee.
We haven't seen anybody here. Exactly. No one's gotten faster on the second one, barring Thomas and Kevin, so. Well, I know the top guys are going to be looking to change that, definitely, and they're going to need to in order to have a potential to beat him.
Well, you know somebody set fire to Thomas and Kevin's underwear, don't you? I mean, there's no question about that. That first heat, they're just not going to... You know, you either walk away from the sport or you just... OK, no, I'm not having that. They went for the second option. 3,500's back, and unfortunately, he's slipping down the order, Corey Butner, down into fifth place at the moment.
Yes, he had a big hit near the top of the track, and that, again, just kills his time.
Top speed equal to Florschutz, so he should stop bleeding speed here. Oh, apart from that.
Big hit out of 18. Again, that's the longest straightaway on this whole entire track.
Up to second place, so he retains his position, with the exception of Florschutz, who is just climbing over everybody at the moment. Corey Butner will finish no worse than 13th spot. Almost every sled in this entire race is going to come up and see the two fingers held out to them. You are not the leader. And he must have expected that, because Florschutz was just so fast in that second heat.
I think definitely as a pilot, it's something you know. You can hear the downtimes, you can hear the start times in the start house before you go down for a second run. It's just something that, you know, you wish you could change, you really hope, and you're not 100% sure. It doesn't distract you too much. Definitely, you know, can play into your mind, but overall, you do what you can. Comes across, big skid, big hit there. You know, that's going to cost him a little bit of time, but it is near the bottom of the track, and like we saw, he still was able to maintain all the way through.
Just 1/100th ahead of Corey Butner from the first heat, Manny Mahata, with Christian Poser behind him. Mahata not on the podium here last year in two-man, but won the four-man race. Christian Poser again on the back of that four-man sled. Handle out long into corner one, 6.07 getaway, so they're trying to run it a long way. Not sure it helped them that much. Let's take a look at the speed. High 66 is 67.1. It did help them. Only one sled faster through that trap. Well, now, can Mahata recover from 11th place? What must be a disappointing run for a German driver. Odd kind of high-pitched metallic rattle from these FVS sleds. They sound different to anything else, the way they vibrate.
They do, and sometimes seems to be paying off, and sometimes, you know, I'm not quite sure it does, but their sleds, those FES sleds, are some of the fastest sleds in the world, and, you know, your tech is doing everything they can. I think they're rivaling them, but they're probably one of the only other countries, the U.S., with their Bodine top three sleds in the world, for sure.
Kevin's nodding off there now out of lack of excitement. That's a 60.99 slide for Manny Mahata, and that puts him into second place. At one stage, he was behind Corey Butner and Ivo De Bruyn, but managed to find the pace at the bottom of the track.
Their biggest disadvantage, I think, was at the start. They were 1600s down at the start from Thomas and Kevin, and that's really hard to make up. Looks like Manny got stuck a little bit at the start. Takes a little bit to get in and get that push bar down. Not going to cost too much time.
Of course, Nelly, if the wall is turning you round, then it's slowing you down as it does that for you, because it takes energy out of the sled. Thomas Florschutz leads from teammate Manuel Mahata. 10 to go. Can Florschutz stage the greatest recovery since Lazarus to win?
2 minutes break. 2 minutes break. Next start. 2 minutes. 2 minutes. The prochain départ. Il cause de 2 minutes. Chers amis spectateurs, soyez les bienvenus si vous rejoignez à l'instant ici sur la piste de la ville de la Plagne. La compétition est exactement la Coupe du Monde entre la deuxième et la deuxième manche multi-pause, puisque c'est en direct sur de nombreuses télévisions et ça s'appelle une pause pub. On va reprendre dans moins de 2 minutes la Coupe du Monde à la Plagne avec l'Espagne, savoir au moment.
To go here in La Plagne in France, and our race leader, who started joint last in the field, is Thomas Florschutz. Next up, Alexander Zubkov of Russia. Well, Zubkov has been close to the medals so far this season, and among them, there's your leaders. They went 0.6 seconds quicker in their second heat than in their first. Nobody else has improved by more than single digits in hundredths of a second. Huge lift off the ice from Dmitry Chernenkov and Alexander Zubkov, his driver. They know they've got a lot to do here to try and stay in front. I'm Martin Abel alongside me, Kaylee Humphries, Olympic champion. Kaylee, this is turning into one of those bizarre races where nobody is knowing what to expect next.
No, definitely not. I mean, these next couple pilots definitely have to have very consistent but even better runs than their first in order to even have a chance to catch up to Thomas. But Thomas had a great second run. I think, you know, something wasn't quite right. I don't know. I can't say equipment, because things can't go different between first and second run. Ice temps, major mistakes, something happened first run, but he's really coming back, and I think we're going to see him on the podium position for a long time to come.
125 kilometers an hour, only two sleds have gone quicker than that. Zubkov is flying, but has he got enough speed? He's gone from a tenth up at the start to 2400s behind. That skid will take another 500s out of the sled. He's going to be 3500s behind. No, he hangs on to it, but he still goes down, and he remains in second place. Now, one of the things that's bizarre about this race, Kaylee, is that everybody in the top 20 so far just about has maintained their position respective to those sleds around them, despite the tiny hundreds of a seconds gaps except for Florschütz.
Yep, except for Florschütz, everyone is very similar. I mean, even with Zubkov there, you saw him, you know, he definitely got faster by about a tenth of a second on the second run, but it just isn't enough. Thomas absolutely blasted that start with Kevin, and amazing run.
Well, Zubkov in 10th place was only 15 hundredths ahead of 20th place, or 19th equal, Florschütz and Rico Pater. So the gaps, 10 to 20, were just insanely tight. Florschütz going 6 tenths quicker. Really, the sky's the limit. Zubkov lies second. He'll get a top 10 finish potentially out of this. What about Max Arndt? Well, started in 15th in the draw after being disqualified in last weekend's race for starting before the timing lights were on. Martin Putzer behind him. Well, Max Arndt, oh, into the wall and a huge skid. That's it, gone.
Done. 6:15. Not much you can come back from that. Any velocity they put is completely gone, and they have no chance of catching Thomas whatsoever. I think you're just going to see them play time. They're ranked fifth now, fifth as a start. You know, Max can really drive, but that was a big mistake to come out of the grooves, to run it. I don't know if it was their load. Max just didn't have the D-rings. However it goes, that huge skid hit the wall, skidding all the way around one.
Well, I said this about...
You can't make those mistakes at the top.
I said this about a couple of skeleton sliders last weekend at Winterberg. If there was a left-hand turning into the car park before corner one, half a dozen skeleton sliders who hit the wall in corner zero would have gone straight in there, parked it and gone home. And that's exactly what Arndt wants. He's 9 tenths behind. He's already 10 spots further back. He could end up at the bottom of the field. He will be at the bottom of the field, surely. 10th place now, no. He's in front of Jürgen Lewacke and Patrice Sevel. So an 18th place finish for Germany 3's Max Arndt. A wry smile from Kevin Kuska there.
That's a harsh one to take. That's one of those ones. It's just a huge mistake. So big, there's nothing you can do to come back from it.
Horrendous. Horrendous.
You see them going load. Max gets in. Martin gets in, but right as they're all getting in,
it was Max.
You just see the sled go in.
It was Max. When he sat down, the sled jumped out of the spurs.
The sled went out. Martin is still in the air.
Yep. Often it's the brakeman loading sideways that chucks it out, but Max Arndt, what a couple of weeks he's had. Disqualified last week, pretty much last this week. Christmas can't come soon enough for him, eh?
No, definitely not. I'm going to assume his foot got stuck in one of the D-rings and turned the sled and pulled it over to that one side of the wall.
Thomas Florschütz leads from Alexander Zubkov. 8 to go. This is Alexander Kazyanov of Russia with Max Belugin behind him. Russia 2 ahead of Russia 1 in the first heat. You know they want this so badly now.
So badly.
Now, can they get under 6 seconds at the start? No, just out. 6:01, so fractions slower than their teammates. I think now everybody has to forget about Florschütz and just, you know, concentrate on themselves. I think the standout thing about his first drive, Kaylee, was how quiet the sled was, how little was going on. And actually, his lead has lasted longer than anybody else's so far.
It definitely has. I think as we get closer and closer to these top pilots, it's going to last farther and farther down the track, and it's going to come down to what you did at the top in those last couple hundredths of a second at the bottom.
700's back. 124.5, though, he's going to lose more speed at the bottom. The gap will grow. He's still in second. He's still ahead of Zubkov. 900's. He's still in front of Zubkov.
Nice straightaway, 18 to 19. He's going to take that speed down into this last and final corner with him.
He's going to beat the boss. He does sure beat he the does. Boss ahead of Alexander Zubkov. Well, come on, Pierre, cheer up. You've got two Russian sleds looking strong in the top seven positions.
He did,
position.
And they actually had the exact same downtime. Slower start time. Kazyanov must have drove better, but definitely the exact same downtimes for both Russian teams on that second run.
Okay, for Pierre to be really cheerful, they'd have to be tied for first with that tie. I understand that. But good start from these guys. They really dug it out.
Very good start. 6:01, again, the only, besides Thomas and Kevin, the next team to push faster on their second push than first push. Hits the wall a little bit on the right before going into that corner. just makes it for a bit of a rough entrance. And those are those little tiny mistakes that you don't think make a difference, but every hundredth of a second counts. And those were definitely a couple hundredths right there.
Next up, seventh after the first heat with Oskars Melbardis is Damons Driskins, the brakeman of Latvia 1. And there are your leaders, Thomas Florschütz on the left and Kevin Kuska on the right. Well, I'm not sure we've seen anybody spend 55 minutes in a leader's box. We may. Just may. Well, Melbardis, fastest starter in the first heat. Track start record these guys set last year, 5.73 seconds. Is it in danger here? Meatload again. They just get the energy in. 5.79, identical. No, a fraction slower than their first 5.78.
Very good start times. These guys are amazing to watch at the beginning. So powerful, so strong, and so quick. They're so big to get in, and just awesome. Light hit there on the left-hand side. Again, sleds moving straight in a fast line.
By 0.4. We've only seen one sled lead at the second talk, and that was by 0.03. Is this where Florschütz gets stopped in his tracks? 0.3, and still a kilometre of ice to go. 0.2, 1:24.5, not as quick as Florschütz. 1/10 of the next clock. 1800s.
It's going to be real close. It's going to come down to this.
Little weave and a little grab. Will he take the lead from Thomas Florschütz and deny the German a top six finish? He does. Okay, it's goodbye from the leader's box for Thomas Florschütz. And our network producer John Morgan said Holcomb, who is the next sled, will be the first to stop him. But they were only 1/100 apart. So that's how far it got.
Those were two very consistent starts from the Latvians, two very consistent drives. He should be very, very happy with this result.
Absolutely right. Well, there's never been a question about their speed at the start.
No.
Kaylee, it's all about handling it down the track.
It's all. And if you look at their legs, they're huge. They're so powerful and strong. They're big guys, you know. 6'3", 6'4", I have no idea how tall they are, but they are ridiculous and just monsters.
Yeah. Well, you know, you must be able to see the parallels with yourself. When you started to drive as a brake woman, you had all that power, all that speed, and then it's learning not to hit stuff.
It definitely is. And in this run, in both of these runs, both very consistent, he did a great job. This is definitely, I think, the first step in what we're going to see to be a very long and very good career to come for them.
That may be the two best drives of his career. Oskars Melbardis leads Stephen Holcomb and Stephen Langton sixth after the first heat. Three race wins this season in North America for Holkey. 31-year-old from Park City, unbeaten till he came to Europe. 5.91 getaway, exactly the same as their first start.
He's definitely still going to have a good drive in order to keep Thomas moving down the line and not continue to move up. Although he's not in the leader's box, it's still an extremely close and tight race. He's going to be looking, though, to have a better drive than the first run in order to move up a couple positions with still five sleds ahead of him.
Yeah, he was only 1900s off a gold medal, and that is achievable on this track with a good drive. They were second quickest starters in the first heat. They've matched that in the second. He's down to within 0.07 of the leader. And this is where his experience pays, Kaylee. Better speed than the Latvians.
It does.
He will take the lead.
You saw the Latvians just bleed time this whole way, and you're going to see Holcomb make that up. He's an amazing pilot, definitely one that I look up to. And a few taps there on the left-hand side. He knows how to just be able to let it run and minimize damage. And
run. A 60.66 second slide, 1600s of a second quicker than his first heat. If he'd done that run in the first run, he would have led the race.
He definitely would have been, but that's where consistency in our sport is a big thing and something that we really all have to work on, even at the top level. You've got to have two runs back-to-back, so he should be very happy with that run. Overall, it was great. Huge, strong, powerful start from both Stephen and Stephen. You see him kick out, really getting every last little bit. Get in, get down, no movement from the sled. They take every little bit of velocity. Comes out of 18, he's hugging that left wall, slight little tap, but again, runners are going straight, and he's just allowing the sled to run free, which is the fastest line possible.
There are the Stevens, Holkey on the left, Langton on your right. They lead with five to go. This could be a big day for several teams, first of which Edwin van Kalke of the Netherlands with Sibrin Jansma behind him. Now, if ever a start was made for Sibrin Jansma, this is it. 6 foot six of him with about 38 inch inside leg, I would have thought. He can stride this out down to corner two or three. Sibrin is just changing up through the gears, fourth, fifth, hits sixth gear as he leaps in, and a 6.06 getaway. That's going to see them maybe outside the top 10 starters, but it gives Edwin a chance, but he gives some of that away there.
Definitely big skid from two to three. That's going to cost some time. One, two, and three on this track is extremely flat. You got to keep it moving forward. You got to keep moving straight, and no skidding or hitting at all, or any advantage that you've given yourself at the start just bleeds it the rest of the way down.
Oh, he's down to fifth place already, still with four sleds to go. I was going to say a top half dozen finish would really, really help the Dutch with their funding and their Olympic qualification criteria. And today was a day when it could have come, but that transition two to three may have just shut that door for them. 1:24.5, not as quick as Holken. Well, all these funding boxes being ticked are so important. Little skid again there, still in fifth place. And that's where he gets the line, 101.19. Holcomb may be in the medals with that second run of his. Well, you can see him throw his head back. Kayleigh, we talk about graveyards of time. Corner two was his graveyard.
Yeah, it definitely was. We'll see it here. The starts, strong, powerful. I mean, Sibrin is just so tall and big and strong, and he really just runs it right into corner one. You see Edwin get in, still again, nursing that bit of an injury, gets in, comes out of two here, and just skids the whole way down, hits on the left, and just goes completely the wrong direction into three. And that kills any little start, and that's what crushed him for a second run.
Motorcycle racers and rally fans will spot an opposite lock flick that used to slow the car down. That's not what you want in a bobsled. Well, we talked about potential big days for nations, and it could be a big day for Great Britain. John Jackson and Bruce Tasker, fourth after the first heat, seven hundredths of a second behind the leader. Well, there's Stephen Holcomb on the left, Steve Langton on the right, and now it is about the medals. The gaps here are so insanely tight on this 1,500 meters of ice that anything could happen. It's within Jacko's power to get himself into the top three, and who knows? Potentially, he could go right to the top with the ride of his life here. Topa haven't just set the bar too hard.
Again.
Oh, and a huge slide into the first corner.
And a big skid into that first corner. Getting down and in off the start is so important. That's really going to cost some time. Again, they're already dropped down to third at this point. Hopefully, he can stop the bleeding and minimize the damage as best as possible. But to really move up, it's going to be very difficult.
Their first corner speed, 65.9. In the first heat, it was 67.1 kilometers an hour. They're already down to fifth place. So he is going to do well just to finish in the top 10. And like Van Kalke, long before he got to any of the notifiable hotspots on the track, the damage was done. 125 kilometers an hour. Again, great speed from the Hilti sleds, and that's something we always see from Hans Hiltebrand sleds. When the speed numbers are high, they're right there at the top. Still fifth. Oh, he's going to be heartbroken at the end of this. I mean, empirically, it's a good drive to recover from that first corner. But Holcomb leads and gets closer to a medal.
At this point, you know what, you can see Bruce, they're going to be disappointed, they're going to be upset. It was all in the start and corner one, that was everything. The drive was decent, everything about those two runs was great, it just all came down to the start, and that was it. You see him load, you see him get in, everything looks clean, and the sled just goes to the left, and you're going to hit the wall. You're going straight for the wall, comes out, the whole back end of the sled skids. There's not much you can do, that's just horrible when that happens. Worst feeling, too, to have to drive down after something like that.
But the potential is there, clear for them to see. Well, they slip down to fifth spot. We have three sleds to go. Our top eight sleds were from eight different nations. When was the last time that happened? Here's Simone Battazzo of Italy with Francesco Costa in third position. Two-man wins in his career. It's been a while since Cesana 2009 when he won the second of them. Sled of his own modification. This will be 6.04. They started 5.99 in the first heat, which is a great start for the two Italians. 66.8 kilometres an hour. That's good speed, but he's going to struggle to stay in front of Stephen Holcomb for the medals.
First run, great start, really great drive. Simone knows how to drive, and you know we'll see as we get farther and farther down this track. Hopefully, he can make up that 10th that he's behind currently at the moment.
Kayleigh Humphries, the Olympic champion beside me here, winner yesterday, calling the action as we watch the battle for the medal. Steve Holcomb still leads, still not getting any further away, but not getting any closer. Not as quick as Holcomb.
He's maintaining that 10th position. He's driving this track just as well as Holcomb, basically. This is what it's telling us. The last three of the splits have been the exact same. They're both allowing the sled to run, having good runs. Stephen made it up at the beginning, and you see it there.
Holcomb is in the medals, and Battazzo slips to second spot. Is he out of a medal? Well, it's such a turnaround from last year, where he was sitting in at the start with a badly torn hamstring. The foreman, the brakes broke here, and he just shot straight out of the end of the finish area as well.
In our sport, anything's possible, and you really see that at the start and at the beginning. In this line there, he goes really high, dips really low, but at the same time, on that specific corner, on corner 16, you can let it do that, and it's about letting the sled run free. Third fastest speed at the bottom, obviously that line pays off.
Well, great speed from that Italian sled. He goes over to offer his congratulations to Langton and Holcomb. And Holcomb leading with two to go. How did you do that?
I don't know.
Now, two sleds separated by 0.02 seconds after the first heat remain. Bernd Hefti took the bronze medal last year behind Thomas Florschütz and Steve Holcomb, our current leader. Then he had Thomas Lampater on the sled, as he did last weekend. This weekend is Alex Baumann, who has joined the World Cup Tour as his alternate brakeman.
Bad, just a driving force at the start, has been for years and will continue to be. I mean, 5.95, not the fastest start, about 0.2 off Malbrunas, but definitely up there with the whole rest of the crew.
Well, listen, Holcomb had such a storming second run. This is for Hefti to lose, but can he hold on?
So far, very clean run, very nice 6. Comes out 7. He's 0.08 ahead.
Gap is coming down. Is he going to be in the red? Still just there. He needs to have 125 and change. It's not enough. Holcomb was 125.0 as well. Will he hang on in the lead? 400. It's going to be so close. A skid there. That's 100th or two. What's he got at the bottom? Oh, and hits the wall and still just takes it. Holcomb's not going to win here. Hefti has the lead with one to go. Well, Bernd Hefti won last weekend. Stephen Holcomb and Stephen Langton will be in the medals. They took silver last year ahead of Hefti. He turns the tables on them here this year.
Sled comes through that corner again. Really nice, smooth line. He's in the middle of all the lines that you can see that have gone through that corner. Again, tied for third, one of the fastest speeds by the bottom. Overall, very good, very nice, clean run. Comes out, you see a slight, tiny skid, but he straightens it out by just kind of giving it the little cha-cha-cha with the runners right at the beginning of that straightaway, and he goes right down into 19 nice, and he's able to maintain his lead.
Robert Hefti's record so far this season, one World Cup race, one win. Could he take the gold medal here? Well, Lyndon Rush last year finished in fifth spot in La Plagne. He and Jesse Lumsden lead after the first heat here. And they started 5.93 in the first heat. You know Jesse will be desperate to try and go quicker. 5.93, right on the money.
Everything comes down to Linden now in the drive. Jesse did his job. They've both done extremely well at the starts. He's going to have a little bit of a hit there before four, but again, a clean exit of four, which is really what you need, because four to five is a decent straightaway as well.
Out started Hefty by 200s, doubled their advantage. They had almost exactly the same speed through the first trap. They are now double their advantage again, 700s in front.
Overall, this run is looking really nice. It's looking really smooth. 1300s, he's gaining time. Linden knows how to drive this track. The Eurotech sleds are running really well. It and Jesse started awesome. He's 2 tenths ahead. This is so good.
126.3 kilometers an hour, 78 and a half miles an hour. Nobody's even been close to that speed. He can skid here all he likes. It is going to be the first win of the season for Linden Rush of Canada. He takes it by a quarter second and change.
1 minute 55. I think that is the fastest run we have seen here today.
Second fastest run, 1 minute and 57 seconds. You want to guess who that was? You know already. It was Thomas Florschütz. Just 200s of a second slower than the leader, but Florschütz ends up in sixth spot, and Linden Rush wins the gold medal here in La Plagne. Wow. That just looked so confident, so comfortable. And Lumsden's going to be insufferable on the way back to the airport, isn't he? Another outstarting a bit, Hefty. Great stuff from the two Canadians.
Definitely a good way to end this first half of the season before Christmas. He should be very proud of himself. Both of them should be. They started great, looked awesome, and those drives were brilliant. Linden, he just let it flow, let it run. He really felt the track. Eurotech sled's running well. Overall, it worked out today.
What position did you finish?
Awesome.
Just asking Thomas Florschütz, where did you get to?
Sometimes the 19th, draw's not in your favor.
No. 19th to 6th. And again, you know, he's taking that view of it as well. Sometimes the draw's not in your favor. He said, you know, you've got the frosty ice. Wow. Well, you know, what's to critique in this run, Kelly? Go on, I dare you. Try and find something.
Not much. You really see Linden reach over there as he loads. Strong, powerful. Jesse jumps in. Both of them really take that speed. He comes around. He's not the highest lines. He's not the lowest lines. He's right in the middle, and he's letting that sled do what it does best.
Well, do you know what? He absolutely did let it fly. 126.3 kilometers an hour, a full kilometer an hour quicker than anyone else got close to. And he led the first heat by 200s, added a quarter of a second to that in the second heat. Stephen Holcomb comes up from what was sixth in the first heat to take the bronze medal ahead of Simone Batazzo, Oscars Melbardis, and Thomas Florschütz, 19th to 6th. That's one for the statisticians. Has anybody gone higher from a lower finish? Well, we will find out what our leaders think right after this. Stay with us live in La Plagne.
Chez les hommes pour demain matin, rendez-vous de sport, de glace, de glisse, de temps.
Plagne in France, top five on the FIBT Wiesmann World Cup. Stephen Holcomb still leads the World Cup rankings ahead of Alexander Zubkov. And today's winner, Lyndon Rush, rockets up to third place in the standings ahead of Manny Mahata. And look at the rookie, Corey Buttner, still fifth in those rankings. Teammate Nick Cunningham also in the top 10 in his rookie season. They're going to feel pretty happy with their year as they go home for Christmas. Well, lots to talk about here. Olympic champion Kaylee Humphries. Lyndon Rush, what an up-and-down year he's had, but today he was just in the form of his season so far.
Definitely was. These are two of the, like, awesome starts, and he definitely two of his most consistent runs of the year. He should be extremely proud of how he did here today. And hopefully, you know, this is just the very beginning of what should be the rest of a very successful season for him.
Well, his season goes like this. 7th, 20th, 2nd, 6th, 1st. Yeah, they've got it. They just need to find it every weekend. Let's hear what he thinks about it as we catch up with our top three. John Morgan is there.
Okay, giving the flowers away, the manager of the track and the competition here from France, Jean-Marc Ganzer. Great job they've done here in La Plagne, France. Jean-Marc now presents it to our gold medalists from Switzerland. From Canada, and now we'll go for the interviews. Bronze medal for Team Stephen Holcomb. Steve, second guy off. I don't know if that was a disadvantage, but boy, you guys had two great starts and seemed like two good drives.
Yeah, and unfortunately, the track wasn't prepped the best that I was hoping for that number two draw, but we overcame it the second heat and moved up from sixth to third. Two huge starts from Langton, which kept us in the game and took it from there and came out in third place. Pretty happy with that.
Yeah, bronze medal. Congratulations, United States. Now over to second place from Switzerland. Good start here with the Brakeman, huh? And good driving.
Ja, ich denke, wir können wieder zufrieden sein heute mit dem Start und mit der Fahrt. Wir nehmen den zweiten Platz und gehen jetzt in die Weihnachten.
Yeah, it's about the start and the drive, and he's happy with everything. And Merry Christmas, congratulations. Now, okay, you guys, you had a 20th place finish in one of the races this year. Today, you just blew away the field, Lyndon. I mean, your speed was way 1 kilometer better than anybody down the speed trap. 126.7, nobody else was in the 126. What was it?
I thought it was the push. I didn't know. Yeah. I guess it was the drive. No, I'm just playing. No, you know what? We have a great support crew that set our sleds up. I don't touch my sled until I push it. And with the guys who do all the work on our equipment, they do an unbelievable job. So I've got to give them a lot of credit.
Well, very humble athlete. Congratulations, you guys, everybody. Yes.
Humble. He doesn't touch the sled until he's pushing it. That's not exactly what he meant. Well, congratulations indeed to Jesse Lumsden and Lyndon Rush. A great drive. He really just left the field behind him. And all the podium finishers doing a good job. And Thomas Florschütz, let's get some money on him now to win tomorrow's four-man race to make up for today's disappointment in the first heat. Well, Kaylee Humphries will be back in the booth tomorrow, unless I've scared her off too much today. So we look forward to some more fascinating action. Until then, thank you for joining us here live from La Plagne, and you can join us 9:25 local time tomorrow morning for more action wherever you are. Have a good day, won't you? And we'll be back tomorrow live from La Plagne. Right.